It's impossible to continue in this way. In the last, we have elections every 2.5 years. We have today, in the last 10 years, 7 ministries of defense, 9 foreign ministries, and 9 ministries, financial ministries. It's impossible. In the Knesset, in the last Knesset, we saw 23 parties. 23 parties in the last Knesset. In the 60 years, we have 31 governments. This government is number 31. And this really very, very big problem for our future, for our country, for our political system. And only unity government can make decisions in this issue. The set point, it's of course a new policy. We don't understand until today what the really new policy, first of all, of United States in the Middle East. But I think also here we must do many, many efforts to change the approach to the all Middle East problems. First of all, the priorities. I don't think that the first priority is the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. There are really many, many priorities, but it's clear that the problem of Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan and Iraq, it's really, really biggest problems of all our region. I think that our biggest threat, it's not from Palestinians, and our biggest problem, it's only with Iranians. 3 times Iran. Iran with nuclear power and with the missiles. Iran by proxy through Hamas and Jihad. And Iran from Lebanon, also by proxy with from Hezbollah. 3 times Iran, and Iran is the biggest headache not only for Israel but for all international community with their crazy idea to export the Islamic revolution. And I think that must be clear that we need to concentrate all our efforts to put all efforts on Iranian track. The maybe from my point of view, with this short speech, the last point, it's of course the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. I think that we have a mistake when we speak about, you know, about what is the real reason for this long-standing conflict. As you can hear about the occupation, territory, settlement, settlers, all these reasons, in the short words, epistemizes. It's really far from the reality. You must understand that it's not any connection, it's not any, I don't see any linkage between settlements, settlers, and the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. The conflict was before 67, and the conflict was before 48, even before establishing of the State of Israel. What was here before 67? The same the same situation, bloodshed, tension, terror. And PLO and Fatah were established before 67. and Fideyoun and Malé Akrabim and other terror acts was before 67. In the same, if Arab countries really were interested in the Palestinian state, they had the possibility between 48 to 67, 19 years, to create a Palestinian state. But they started to speak about this possibility only after 67. The same in the cities before 48, the riots of cities, the pogrom in Hebron, Tel Hai, all this also was before 67 and before 48. In this case, it's clear that this approach to put all responsibility for the conflict or for solution on settlements and occupation, it's a very big mistake, it's misrepresentation. And without to understand what the real reasons, you cannot find any right solution. After 16 years from the Oslo Agreement, we still in the deadlock. We gave up the Gaza and unilateral disengagement, and we gave up the half of Judea and Samaria, and we brought Arafat and some other terrorists here, and we invest a lot of money in the Palestinian Authority. Even today, we give every month about 200 million shekels to Gaza Strip. And in this case, maybe it's a time to convince a new administration to adopt any new idea, new approach to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And we have some ideas, but I think it's. I spoke in New York with, in your office, in one meeting about my idea. I don't think that today it's a time for a new plan. But in any case, I think every place around the world where you have two nations, two religions, you have two languages, you have a friction and you have a tension and you have terror. We can start from Quebec in Canada, and from Quebec, from Canada, we can move to, even today, to the Belgium, and from Belgium to the Northern Ireland, and from Northern Ireland to the Balkanian region, and from Balkans to Caucasus area in Russia. I think we must understand that the friction between two nations from one side and the global clash between two civilizations, it's really two big reasons for this long-standing conflict. When I speak about worldwide clash between two civilizations, I think that really, the 11th September in New York, the terrorist acts in London, in Paris, in Bali Island, it's without any ties, without any connection, without any linkage to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And we saw the reaction of the extremist Muslim world to the speech of Pope, cartoons of Muhammad, even, you know, until today, nobody canceled the death sentence against Salman Rushdie. And I don't know any political or spiritual leader within Islamic world who condemned this death sentence. And I think that also it must be, there are many, many hypocrisy in regarding our problems and our issues. And maybe it's a time to put on the table really all these problems and without double standards. I met a week ago some very important guest from the United States, and he spoke with me about human rights and what happens with the Palestinians, and I said, and I say again, I will be ready to speak about human rights in Israel after the congressional hearing about human rights in Saudi Arabia. When we will see congressional hearing or hearing in the European Parliament about human rights in Saudi Arabia, I will be ready to speak about human rights in Israel regarding our internal problems and the other problems. I think that it's main points from my point of view, and I must leave in 10 minutes. If there are some small questions, I will try to explain myself. Maybe Daniel will be ready to continue this meeting. Yeah, I think I can.
At this point, we'd like to ask all the media to leave so that he can have a formal discussion with the conference at this stage. Thank you.
We have three speakers: Nimrod Barkhan, Deputy Director General, Political Research Department; Lieutenant General Moshe Bugi Yaalon, Senior Fellow, Adelson Institute for Strategic Intelligence Collection. From 1977, he started to serve as advisor on Palestinian affairs in the
I was given 10 minutes to discuss the Palestinian arena, what's going on inside, and I know that we've got a lecture from Professor Shkaki this morning, that also visited the Southern Command. And I'll try to do telegraphically or to try to describe the trends inside the Palestinian political map. I think that we came this year to the top of the inside divisions and splits inside the Palestinian arena. And the reason is, there are some reasons, but first of all, one of the problems is paralyzed in a leadership. And you are going to hear immediately why. The leaderships, because there are too many leaderships, and actually we don't have one Angus. I think that this situation of not having one Angus in the Palestinian people will be the same also next year. I explain later why, and that's why we are not going to have a credible Angus in the West Bank and Gaza, unless we are speaking about shooting on us or sitting with them and trying to come to some written papers, but never able to implement them in the field. I'm talking about the peace process, not arrangement. The year of 2009, to my opinion, will be important, but also very complex and problematic in the inside developments in the Palestinian arena. And I think that the year of 2008, the year that we just finished, ended a process in which the Palestinian people have ended a long process of division and splitting on three levels. One level is the level of the demographical level, which is two states, actually. They have two states now. The state of Hamas, Hamastan in Gaza, and the second state, we call it inside on the desk, the Fatah state on the West Bank. The second level is the level of the government, the PA. The split is so deep now that we have two governments. We have a government in Gaza that was derived from the PA, and now the Hamas says that they are the real government in the territories, at least in Gaza. And the second one, of course, the government in Ramallah. And we have, and that's the most important, and we don't, in Israel, many people don't have to think about it most of the time, is that we have also two leaderships inside the organizations that until some years ago led the Palestinian struggle and the Palestinian people. This is the PLO. We have two leaderships of the PLO now. In fact, although not declared, one is Abu Mazen, and the second one that tried to describe itself already as a parallel leadership to Abu Mazen is the leadership of Hamas and other organizations like Islamic Jihad that are not part of the PLO. They are not inside the PLO, they were never inside the PLO, they do not recognize all the agreements the PLO signed with us and with others, and they are now saying, loud and clear, we are now also a leadership of the Palestinian people, not only you, and they base many of the results of the elections, of two campaigns of elections that happened in 2005-2006, one as a campaign for elections for the municipalities, in which Hamas gained in the most of the biggest cities more than 70% of the votes. And the results for the Palestinian parliament, 2006, the result was 62% of the seats to Hamas in the parliament. So the struggle now inside the Palestinian people is not only who runs the business in the field, who is running which ministry, but also who runs the top leadership of the Palestinian people. And when I'm talking about Palestinian people, I'm talking about the Palestinian people inside the territories, West Bank, Gaza, and also Jerusalem, or East Jerusalem in their eyes, and second, in the diasporas, outside. Or to put it in the words of Mr. Mashal, the head of Hamas in Damascus, Hamas outside, we are now on the struggle of what he calls in El Haram, in one of the interviews, PLO number 3. The first PLO was, for those of you who remember, the PLO of the 60s of Shukeri. The second one was of Yasser Arafat, that brought the Fatah in, kicked Shukeri out. And now we are going to kick Fatah out, and we are going to be the leaders of the PLO for the next coming years. This brings, of course, the question of who is the source of authority in the Palestinian people. Until today, the source of authority, recognized by all the Arab world and the whole world, actually, was the PLO. Now they say that the PLO is not anymore. When I say they, I mean at least those who lead more than half of the Palestinian people, and this is Hamas, that they are the source of authority, what they call in Arabic, marja'i, the source of authority. These two splits falls also according to the lines of the much wider split in the Arab world, and this is the split between the goodies and the bad guys, the good guys and the bad guys, what we call the pro-Western bloc, which was until the war in Gaza very weak and almost non-active, and the axis of the bad guys, which is led by actually by Iran, Hezbollah in Syria, and of course Hamas. The first one is ready to sit with Israel and to come to some political arrangements and political agreements and recognize Israel in some given borders. The question is, what borders? The pro-Iranian camp calls for the destruction of Israel this way or other, openly, in a very, very open way. What's the situation of Abu Mazen vis-a-vis Hamas and the Hamas vis-a-vis Abu Mazen? Abu Mazen, if to put it in so many words, is strong in the international arena, but very weak inside. Hamas is very weak in the international arena because they don't get, until now, enough recognition, only for a few, but very strong in the inside, which means inside the territories, inside the Palestinian society. And their struggle now is not only to take over Gaza, but to try and step by step, not necessarily by force, maybe at the end of the day also by force, but step by step to take over the West Bank through taking over of different civilian organizations. Our problem is that a year from now, or less, in January 2010, Abu Mazen goes home. And I mean it. He finished his job as the president of the PLO, of first of all of the PA. They do not recognize him already as the head of the PLO, many of them at least, and we are going to stay without a leader of the PA. Now, the only way to change it is to make elections. How you can make elections when Hamas controls Gaza and Abu Mazen at least partly controls the West Bank? Very hard. And they are talking about elections, new elections will come for the presidency and for the parliament, The question is how to do it. None of us have a question. I think the Palestinians don't have to. So we are going, we might stay in January 2010 in a situation that we don't have inside the PLO camp an address or a top leader that we can speak to. We don't see a real leader that can be emerge out of the existing forces. I know that this morning you were told by Mr. Shkaki that Barghouti is a solution. Allow me to assume that Barghouti can bring some force to the Fatah camp, but he cannot rebuild all the Fatah camp in Gaza Strip in the West Bank. The maximum that he is efficient on is his area, which is Ramallah and some district around, like maybe Bethlehem and Jerusalem, if he will be freed. I'm not saying that I'm for it or against it, I just describe what we think on the desk on it, at least some of us. The PLO and mainly Fatah failed also in rebuilding and reconstructing its own political camp. I'm talking about the inside problems of the party. They have not succeeded until now. They are talking a bit about it for the last 16 years to convene the sixth convention of the Fatah organization, the general convention, 16 years and more. And part of it because of Arafat, here now, because of the weakness, Arafat simply dragged it and did not allow it. He simply paralyzed most of the inside institutions of the PLO and Fatah. And now it's the weakness of Abu Mazen. They said that they will do it in March this year. Now I hear a new timing, which is somewhere in April. So they postpone it on and on and on. One of the problems inside the Fatah is the change of generations. They fail to make a change of generations because they fail to convene the inside institutes of the PLO, of the Fatah first, and then of course the PLO. Hamas, on the other side, also have a dilemma. And they stand between the dilemmas that I think Nimrod mentioned before concerning Hezbollah. They see themselves as a movement of resistance. But in the same time, and resistance was the main line. Meaning what we call terror and they called armed struggle against Israel. Every day, every week, if they can. The problem is that for the first time, and not by pre-planning in advance, they have got to their hands a state in Gaza. And they have to run a state. And suddenly they see the contradiction between the two. The question is, can you run a state in one side and build an infrastructure, and at the same time, to run a daily war against Israel that closes the passages, or Egypt that closes the Rafah passage, and things like this, can it go together? They discover every day that it's harder and harder to do it. So the contradiction between resistance and state building. I think that the war in Gaza cleared to Hamas two things, at least. One, they saw that there is a new Hezbollah in the south. Well, they discovered that they are not Hezbollah. They are far from being it. They are dangerous for the Israeli, we'll talk about the Israeli army, maybe General Yaron will talk about it too. They are dangerous, they are hard to be broken, but Israel succeeded to crash, if you ask me, or to find the solution for the DNA, for the inside DNA in this last war, of combining resistance and civilians together and guerrilla warfare inside urban areas. The second thing they discovered is that they must take control now in order to rebuild their image, rebuild their infrastructure. They must take control on the financing and the rebuilding of Gaza Strip, rehabilitation effort. So in the next year, we are going to see a very big struggle between the two camps, Fatah in the West Bank and Hamas inside Gaza, on who is going to control the rehabilitation effort and the rehabilitation campaign, and also who is going to control the money. And we are talking here on big sums in the eyes of, at least of the Gazans, something between $2 and $3 billion at least for reconstruction of Gaza. There is also a very big struggle between the two camps, who is going to control the passages. Egypt is trying to bring Abu Mazen through, not through the door, but through the window, to control the passages of Gaza. They try to bring him back to Gaza, or at least to the image. And of course, there is a very big struggle under the table on who is going to control the politics of the West Bank. And Hamas planned this year, 2009, to be the year that they will take control on many institutes in the West Bank. If you allow me to assume, I think that the war in Gaza postponed these two things. First of all, now because they, they deal with the stories in Gaza, with the rebuilding of Gaza, it's a problem for them to move to the West Bank, so they postponed this effort maybe for next year. And no doubt that it also put aside the question of is Abu Mazen, legitimacy of Abu Mazen and his leadership, because it, both sides need each other today, because Abu Mazen has the legitimacy and can bring the money from the West, while the Hamas has the control on the field and can blockade any rebuilding efforts if they want. In the Gaza Strip, Hamas comes back to control. They started to rebuild the institutions that were destroyed. They succeeded already to smuggle tens of millions of dollars to the Gaza Strip. I guess some of you have heard that in, with one delegation of Hamas, the Egyptians succeeded to confiscate something like $9 million in suitcase and 2 million euros. And this is only a small portion from the money that injected through the tunnels and through foreign delegations that are coming in. Hamas knows that they failed in the war that they promised to be a victory for the people in Gaza. So now they're trying to develop the ethos or the ethos of victory, but it's not the same that happened with Hezbollah. They are trying to say, okay, the victory is something less than a full victory, the fact that we had a sumud, we had a steadfastness, and we succeeded to stand on our legs even after what Israel did here, that means victory. In the West Bank, Abu Mazen proved better control on the street, mainly in the first days of the war in Gaza, when Hamas tried to organize riots, and part of it did not happen because the West Bankers doesn't care so much about the Gazans. They don't admit it, but this is the truth for many years. It's not new for us. But part of it, because of the forces of Abu Mazen, those that were trained in Jordan with American support and Western support, and they succeeded to blockade these riots. And I think that now they will come to the American side and say, aha, you see, okay, give us more authority in the West Bank. That will be one of the results. But in the same time, we have to remember that all this success of Abu Mazen in the streets of the West Bank cannot happen without the IDF, the Israeli forces, and the Israeli General Security Service, the Shin Bet. If not the daily and every night effort in which we arrest and capture night after night, day after day, suicide bombers and the helpers, recruiters, supporters, those who, the transmitters and so on, this won't happen. And this very gray and specific work is not done yet by Abu Mazen forces, only small part of it. To conclude all this, I think that in this period and until 2010, Israel will not have a real address in the Palestinian side to sit with and to come to final agreements or peace agreements. We can have some papers that will be in the shelf, concluded with Abu Mazen, but nothing can be implemented. Second, the vulnerability of Abu Mazen grows more and more as time goes on. And I'm not excluding that we'll see in the next year efforts to make what we call from the Hamas side and Jihad side strategic assassinations. Because the disappearance of Abu Mazen means that we are, the Fatah is, and PLO is totally stuck, and elections cannot be done even inside the Fatah itself. The Palestinians in this year, the coming year, will be dealing especially with themselves, with the inside wars. The reconciliation that the Egyptians are now trying to make between Fatah and the Hamas will not be a real one. They can come to some arrangements in order to bring the money. So it will be seen outside that there is some, let's say, speaking between the two camps. But no doubt that this war deepened and widened the splits between the two camps. The biggest effort of two sides will be the war or the fight on who is going to rebuild Gaza and stabilizing the situation. Iran, in this year, will make an upper and very strong effort to upgrade the ability of Hamas in Gaza. And ability, when I say ability, is not only the fighting abilities, but also the rockets' abilities, so they will be able to come to the range, not anymore to Ashdod only, or to Kiryat Gat that you visited, or to Sderot, but also to Tel Aviv and Jerusalem and other places. And this is not something that they will try in the far future. I'm talking about now, an effort that is done now already. Lessons and challenges for Israel. First of all, to see that Hamas will not take over Judea and Samaria, West Bank, through a quiet revolution, if you can call it this way, and not through, of course, assassinations. To see that Iran do not succeed to upgrade again Gaza Strip and give them weapons that will enable them to threaten Israel much deeper and deeper. To try, number three, to try and to support the moderate elements inside the Fatah and other elements in the West Bank that are ready for two-state solution, but not to hug them too much. A bear's hug, because that only can make them problems. And for the end, I want to say something. It's true that the feeling is that Israel have got a victory in Gaza in the last war, at least a victory if we compare it to boxing, in points, not in knockout. In the same time, I think it's important to know that if we think that in the future we'll have this, such a comfort or such an easy, comparing to 2006, war with Hezbollah or Syria, this is not the story. Hezbollah is not Hamas, like Hamas is not Hezbollah, and it's going to be much, much harder. Thank you.
The bus was exploded here in Jerusalem. It was the time of the homicide bombers, bombing attacks. The situation today, as you can feel, is very different. It is not because of any change in the Palestinian motivation. It's because of the IDF and the Israeli security agencies' activities since the defensive shield operation. And actually, we succeeded in eliminating the terror capabilities in Judea and Samaria in the West Bank by moving from the defense to the offense on April 2002. In the recent operation in Gaza, what we call now Hamastan, to be more precise, yes, we did quite a lot. The IDF demonstrated again its high capabilities and spirit, but unfortunately, the mission hasn't been accomplished yet. You might hear many details about the situation, and in order to set up the grounds for my proposals, I would like to mention a couple of fundamental elements in the current situation. First of all, our war or our conflict with Hamastan in Gaza is part of the conflict of Islamic jihadism and the Western civilization. Hamas is an Iranian proxy today. And having said that, we have to mention that our main challenge, even after the Second Lebanon War, after Operation Cast Lead, is still the reluctance of too many parties in the region to recognize Israel's right to exist as a Jewish independent state. Or as Professor Bernard Lewis says it again and again, the conflict is not about the size of Israel, but it is very existence. And we have to not to forget it. 1979, to my mind, is a very significant year, affecting the current strategic situation, in which the rise of Islamic jihadism, by the success of the Iranian revolution, inspired, energized, and empowered other Islamic jihadist elements in the region to create Al-Qaeda, Sunni Wahhabi ideology, to create Hezbollah, Shia jihadist ideology in Lebanon, and to encourage the emergence of Hamas in the 80s, a Muslim Brotherhood Sunni ideology in the Palestinian arena. Iran is the main generator and instigator today of Islamic jihadism in the region and the entire world. Iran is the center of gravity and the core for instability in the region should be dealt in this way. And this is not the Israeli-Palestinian conflict as a core for instability in the region. And as the dominating conflict today is Islamic jihadism versus the Western civilization, Israel is only the minor Saturn, America, the West, is the great Saturn. And the Western civilization goal should be to defeat the Iranian regime in order to defeat Islamic jihadism as a whole. Not all Muslims are jihadists, and not all Muslims are terrorists. I commanded Muslim soldiers, Israeli Arab Muslim soldiers in the IDF. But most of the terrorists today are Muslims and jihadists. There is no way to stabilize Iraq or Lebanon or the Palestinian Authority or other moderate regimes in the region, especially in the Persian Gulf, without defeating the Iranian regime. The outcome of the military operation in Gaza on the parties that we mentioned is not clear yet, to my mind. As a discussed prisoner swap will have a significant impact on the long-term perception of the operation. But no doubt that Hamas has paid a very significant price for launching rockets on Israeli civilians, but basically Hamas is able to recover and to strengthen its grip in governing Hamastan and challenging Mahmoud Abbas, as I said earlier, that the mission hasn't been accomplished. Hamastan should be considered and dealt by Israel as an hostile entity and as jihadist regime should be isolated by the international community. The Palestinian Authority in Judea and Samaria in the West Bank should have a chance to prove its competence to govern by launching a new strategy to allow, to support, and to encourage the PA, led today by Mahmoud Abbas in the West Bank, to go through five reforms, which might be called peace from the bottom up. Educational reform, economic reform, political reform, law and order, and security reforms. Today, we witness an economic progress led by the former Prime Minister Blair is going the right way to launch an economic reform from the bottom up. Witness also a law and order reform led by the United States, General Dayton, which is doing quite well in training and deploying Palestinian policemen in the Palestinian cities. But this, it's not enough. You can't talk about peace, coexistence, reconciliation, stability between us and the Palestinians, we join without going through educational reform. They still educate the young generation from kindergarten to become homicide bombers, to admire Shaheeds, martyrs, and so forth. And so we can't avoid it. Israel is not mentioned on the maps. The linkage between the Jewish people and the land of Israel is denied, even by Salam Fayyad, just recently in New York, in the conference hosted by the Saudi Arabian monarchy, in which our President Peres participated, and Salam Fayyad mentioned Jerusalem as a holy city for Christianity and Islam, not to mention Judaism. So this reform is the most important one, the educational reform, first of all. And I mentioned economy, political reform to encourage civil society, and of course, law and order is not security. Since the Oslo, the implementation of the Oslo Agreement, we haven't witnessed any real security measures to fight terrorism, to deal with the murderers of Israelis as murderers, and not in another way of revolving door, or in this case, in many cases, there was no door at all. And I would like, I would mention and say that the Palestinian Authority in the West Bank should have the power to govern themselves, but they shouldn't have any power to threaten Israel. And this is the formula to reach something or progress in Judea and Somalia. Regarding Lebanon, the Lebanese government today, it's especially after the Second Lebanon War, I don't believe that they were affected by Operation Kastled, but the Lebanese government is confronted by jihadists in two forms. Fatah al-Islam, Sunni jihadist ideology, Al-Qaeda ideology, and Hezbollah as Shia jihadist organization. The Lebanese government is doing quite well on the first front, while it's challenged by Hezbollah on the second one. Hezbollah has gained political power after the Second Lebanon War and hasn't been affected by Operation Kastled in Gaza. And the Western interest, to my mind, is to prevent a third jihadist state, as we have Iran as an Islamic jihadist republic, Hamastan in Gaza as a second jihadist entity, as they call it, the second jihadist emirate. Hezbollah is challenging the current coalition in Lebanon to create a third Islamic jihadist republic in Lebanon. So Western interest is to strengthen and to support Sinuba's government and its coalition. Syria in the arena is playing a very negative role by being an ally of the Iranian regime, by supporting Hezbollah as well as Hamas and other Palestinian terror organizations, to include Mujahideen sent to Iraq, not to allow stability over there. Just to mention the difference between late President Hafez al-Assad, the father, and his son, President Bashar al-Assad, the main difference is that when the father discussed the peace agreement with Israel, it was clear that he was ready to give up the strategic relations with Iran and to dismantle all the terror groups, Palestinian terror groups, and Hezbollah in Lebanon. This is not the case with the sun today. To sum up, I would say that Operation Kastled proved again that the IDF is strong and capable to meet its challenges. The Israeli society demonstrated its ability to stand and to fight back its enemies. It is very important that the Israeli society has proven again that it is not a spider web, as Hassan Nasrallah named us. It is not a dry tree, as Reza Ahmadinejad named us. The Israeli society ability to stand has become the most important element in our national security chain And it is challenge in the recent war, not our military might. Even in the Castellet operation, we deployed on the ground only one division out of more, without mentioning the numbers. In the second Lebanon war, we deployed 3 divisions on the ground. And it's not all our military power, but the ability of society to stand has become the most important element in our national security chain. So we have to enhance, I believe, our confidence in our path, in our way, Zionism, and enlightenment. And that is the main reason that in the last 2 years I dealt with education, Jewish identity, as it was mentioned. There is a need, talking about our leadership and Western leaderships, there is a need for clarity, clear understanding of the situation, and clear strategy to meet the challenges. To launch a long run, a long-term strategy for the sake of Israel and Western civilization. Thank you.
Thank you very much. For those of you that want to ask some questions, I notice there's only one microphone in the room. Please line up there. And as is our wont to make statements, please try not to do that so as many of you that have questions can ask them. Ask your
on the current state of relations after Castellet, the current state of relations within Hamas, between the Syrian and the Gaza people, between the political and the military wing, etc.
No, he asked the question of you.
Okay. There is, of course, a division between what we call Hamas outside and inside. Hamas outside is those who sit mainly in Damascus, and Hamas inside is, first of all, those who sit in Gaza, and we have to add to this another leaderships of Hamas that sits in the West Bank, and they are not the same as we used to think as the leadership in Gaza. They have a different policies sometimes, and, for example, Hamas West Bank is sitting many times with Abu Mazen and talk to them, while Hamas in Gaza refused to do it. Now, the outside and the inside, no doubt that every time when the situation becomes tough, become problematic, they have a problem to take decision. Why? Because as a resistant movement, a secret movement that used to have this principle of shura, meaning inside consultation, between the outside and inside, without showing it to the public, without transparency. They succeeded on one side to hide the inside disputes, but they have, because nowadays there are many, many debates inside the Hamas about the question of, for example, should we give up to the Israelis in the number of prisoners that we demand? What should be the demands on the passages? Things that are now here and they are urgent and must be solved now. Now, those who are feeling the pressure of the public about this is not the guys in Damascus. These are the guys who sit in Gaza. They have to give the answers. That's why you see differences inside the two leaderships. First of all, about the urgency of how things should be dealt. And second, about, for example, the number of prisoners or how many tax should be passing in the passages and things like this. In the same time, I want to say that it's not going to a split inside the Hamas leadership. If someone is thinking about this, this is not the case. At the end of the day, they stay outside, united, as much as they can, much less than the Fatah, that all the pleats are, that all the dirty laundry is brought also to the outside. Thank you.
Saudi Arabia plays in the international financing of terrorism, but where are the monies got that will be cut off in Iran? Would there still be sources of funding for terrorism from Saudi Arabia, or is that finished now?
Who's the question for, Bill?
The panel,
please.
Okay, I'll try to answer this, and maybe later my friends. No doubt that Saudi Arabia today, if we talk about reconstruction of Gaza stands with what you call the good guys, meaning Qatar promised in the Doha conference to inject not through Abu Mazen, not through the PA, but civil society, but directly to Hamas, a $250 million, side by side with Iranian money. While Saudi Arabia promised to do it, they talk about $1 billion, to do it only through the Palestinian Authority, only through Abu Mazen, and only through Western systems that were already developed, or are already developed in the West Bank, in order to reconstruct their systems. So if you talk about Saudi Arabian governmental money, that's one story. If you talk about privates, that's another story. Private money, they, no doubt that they, according to my knowledge, they have much better control than they had 10 years ago, mainly because of the American pressure about financing terror, not only here, but also outside. But still, there is a lot of leak of what you call private money from Saudi Arabia to different Islamic organizations, like Rabitat al-Alam al-Islami and Al-Quds Fund and things like this, that sits outside. If you ask about Hezbollah money that come to Hamas,
Saudi money to Hezbollah, Saudi money to Hamas for operations.
No. The Saudis don't send it to Hezbollah if you ask to Hamas. The money, Saudis don't send money to Hezbollah if you ask me as a government. But again, one of the problems is private bodies. Private bodies, private people, better control, but still a lot of problems.
Some people like to see the Saudis as the bête noire, but I don't suggest that you adopt this attitude. The Saudis have been inadvertently, together with the Egyptians, Israel's biggest supporters in 2006 and 2008, and they belong to the pragmatic camp in the Arab world, and for them, Hamas and Hezbollah are the enemies.
Thank you. Malcolm?
I guess a couple of questions, and whoever wants to answer them can answer them. The first is, was it a mistake to wait to respond to Hamas through 8,000 missiles? Should it have been Israel's policy right away to respond or after the first few, and or retaliate each time something happened over the last 7 years, in which people would have understood, I think, rather than trying to explain why, after all the years, you start. Second, could any of you comment about, is there an Al-Qaeda presence now in the West Bank or Gaza? Is there any indications that Al-Qaeda is as well present? And third, could you talk about what the implications of the Chavez and other outreach by Iran beyond and Hezbollah's presence in, for instance, in Venezuela and some other countries in South America, what does that mean in terms of the equation here, the fact that Iran now spreads out and it has the international linkages in order to expand their base and operational capacity. And lastly, the British diplomats are supposedly reaching out. We have American senators today in Damascus. How will Syria read this? Do they see it as a reward without concession, that they have done nothing and are being rewarded by breaking the isolation? Or is there any indication that this really does have a positive impact?
They're negotiating the response. Call out the content.
Regarding the Israeli reaction towards any rockets launched, as I mentioned, the best defense to my mind is a good offense. It's not a passive defense or even active defense. It's a good offense. And unfortunately, we actually ignore the provocations of Hamas. And I believe that the policy and strategy should have been very different. Not to allow even a single shot, which even a bullet, not just, and not even, I'm not talking about a rocket, by charging them with a very heavy price for any provocation. And this is the meaning of the offense in this regard. And this is the best solution to this threat. Regarding the Iranian influence and regard Iranian ties in Venezuela and in other places, it's not a new phenomenon. Just to mention that in Argentina, 92, 94, the Iranian intelligence, actually, using Hezbollah apparatus, late Imad Mouraniya, to launch two devastating terror attacks. They have such capabilities, they had it in the past, they have it today, in South America, in the Far East Asia, in other places. The good news is that after 9/11, the Western intelligence communities are more prepared to deal with this threat. The cooperation between the intelligence communities is the best explanation for the success in foiling those intending attacks. And many attacks have been foiled, even recently. But yes, the Iranian influence is a source of worry for Israel and for the Western world regarding terror and devastating attack all over the world. Regarding the Syrian regime, I believe that President Bashar Assad should have been isolated as leading the rebel regime, challenging the troops in Iraq, the American troops in Iraq, challenging us by Hezbollah in Lebanon, challenging us by Hamas in the Gaza Strip, and challenging the Lebanese government by, I believe, assassinating former Prime Minister Hariri and other Lebanese figures who rejected the Syrian presence and influence in Lebanon. The best way in this case is isolating him, not giving up discussing, which appears to be a concession without getting anything from him.
Anybody else?
Marco, my answer to your question about Al-Qaeda and the territories, and I start mainly in Gaza because that's where there are rumors that there is activity. First of all, there is not such a thing like Al-Qaeda guided groups that guided from somewhere in the mountains between Pakistan and Afghanistan from Bin Laden or Zawahiri. Never happened before, and I don't think that there are. What we have is what we call uncontrolled, and also uncontrolled by Hamas, groups that see themselves at what we call world jihad. Or international jihad, actually they are local, but they have relations to different factions like the Fatah al-Islam that General Yalom just mentioned in Lebanon and get some money from them. For example, what we call Jaysh al-Islam, the Army of Islam, headed by a very big family in Gaza, the Dormish family, the guys that kidnapped the journalist Johnson and took part also in the kidnapping of Corporal Shalit. Or those who are leaving Hamas to much more extreme groups. They are called, in the local terminology now, in Janjalat, that's the name, now it's a new name. And Hamas is very annoyed and very concerned about this. Why? Because these groups are a challenge for him too. They want to show that they have control of the field, that even the Mukawama, the resistance, is controlled, and the ups and downs according to some political thinking. And suddenly you have such guys that running around, as you say, in Hebrew, among their legs, they don't have control of them, and they can ignite the field every moment by an operation that nobody decided in the leadership absence. Okay? So, yes, we have much more extreme guys than Hamas. Hamas did its best at this operation in order to take control of them and to arrest them. We have something that is much more annoying for the short term, if you ask, and this is groups that left of Hamasniks that left the Gaza Strip so that to the Sinai to make operations against Israelis and Egyptian targets, led by people of Hezbollah. And that's very dangerous because it's a Hezbollah controlled groups, bad people that are Gazans, Hamasniks. Thank you.
Last question, Rabbi David.
Stanley Davis, Arts of the Reformed Zionist Organization of America. A question to the three of you, Eddie. This morning we hear Barghouti described in, the Jewish terms, almost messianically, that if Marwan Barghouti is released from jail and he's able to enter the political scene in the West Bank, he would sweep power in the West Bank. He might even receive some support from Hamas. Do you believe that such a power unification under Barghouti is likely? If so, where might it take us?
Okay, I think I referred to it also in my briefing, but I think, and I'm not the only one, that first of all, Barghouti should declare about a change in his policy towards Israel. Now, what is the difference between Barghouti and Abu Mazen? Abu Mazen said, no more shooting. Only negotiations on the table, full stop. Barghouti said, like the Viet Cong, if you remember once with negotiations in the United States, shooting with negotiations. Now, he never came back from this. And that's number one. Second, as I said in my briefing, Barghouti is in many means, he's a product also of the Israeli press and mass media. And the international press, I want to remind you that they made a very big campaign about him, a lot of money, that he's a new Mandela and things like this. Barghouti in jail is a symbol. Barghouti out of jail is maximum the leader of the Fatah in Ramallah, not all of it, and some Fatah guys in the neighboring district, not more than this. That's my knowledge and that's what I see. Thank you.
Anybody else
Marwan Barghouti led the Palestinian terror war, what they call the Al-Aqsa Intifada. He was the alter ego of Arafat. He was the executor of the idea of going back to the armed struggle, to give up the peace process. And I believe that it will be a tremendous mistake to release him from jail after being sentenced for many murders of Jewish people in the last couple of years.
Thank you. Just before I ask Nathan Diamond to come up to thank our panel, I want to thank again Ayel Hendler for being here with us and his company, Bet Yair Real Estate, for sponsoring our luncheon today. Thank you so much, Ayel. And Nathan Diamond, please.